that we are going to cover today is so important for the hour that we are in. And that is why there has been so much been going on in the body of Messiah itself. Because you are now wanting to do a new thing. You are wanting to raise up a priesthood. But how can you raise up a priesthood when the priesthood themselves are still defiled? And so I thank you, Abba Yahuwah, that you are going to speak to my mind and speak through my lips the very oracles that is going to come from your heart. As Abba, I'm not even sure what it is that you want to say, but I know that you have a message in this day. And I know that this message, you have been birthing within me, not only for a day, not only for 2 days, not only for a week, but for weeks now. This message has been part of my life. And I thank you, Abba Yahuwah, that this day, Father, we may be able to stand against the enemy who comes like a viper, who comes to bite us, who comes to try and destroy us, to be able to put his poison within us, Father. But I thank you that you have given us the Lamb, Yeshua Mashiach, our Redeemer, to come and set the captives free. Help us, Abba Yahuwah, in the days ahead, to be able to be mindful of the things that trip us up, and how the enemy comes to want to destroy, to kill, to steal, to destroy, but where you have come to give us life, life in abundance. And so I thank you, Abba Yahuwah, that this day, you are going to be able to reveal your heart's purposes to us, so that we may understand a better revelation of a Torah portion that we would just want to skip in the Bible. Of what importance would this Torah portion be to any of us? But Abba, what an important Torah portion. And from what you've already been speaking within this week, and so I thank you, Abba Yahuwah, that you alone will be glorified in all things. I praise and I thank you for this in Yahshua's name. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to switch off the video so that we can just speak. Okay, so we are covering 2 Torah portions this morning. And the 2 Torah portions that we are covering this morning are so powerful. And I stand in awe because in just what has happened in my own life this week is bringing this Torah portion to very surface. Because at the end of the day, when the Father wants to do a work, the Father's got to birth a message. The Father doesn't just preach a message. The Father needs to birth a message. A message isn't just preached. A message is birthed. And I truly pray that Abba give me the grace to be able to birth this message that needs to come forth to his people who truly in this hour need to understand that the Father is trying to bring us past our the place of where we find ourselves in terms of the fact where the enemy becomes the accuser of the brethren in so many ways. And when I started looking at the Torah portion reading yesterday, I stood and I said, Abba, my Father, what are you trying to tell me? Because everything of what we're reading in these Torah portion readings in the times of what we're going through right now is all lining up with what the Father is doing. So last week, the Father is saying, I want you to be able to become a tabernacle that must carry my presence. But for you to be able to become a tabernacle that's going to carry my presence, we need to understand that this tabernacle needs to be cleansed. And you know, we can cleanse the outer part of ourselves, but you know, it's the hidden sins of the heart that is there so deep that sometimes we cannot see. And the only way that Abba is really able to bring those sins to light is when we come to a place of where we have to go through many things in our lives for us to continue to do introspection. And so this, both these Torah portion readings from Tazaria, she's with seed, and the Metzora, both of them, these two Torah portions that come together, we are going to be able to see a message that is coming from here, that we can see the redemption of how Yeshua has come to bring redemption. But at the same time, we are going to see what it is that we need to raise up in, that we are not walking in. And truly today, I stand before you with fear in my own heart, with the fear of Abba Yahuwah in my own heart. Because you can sometimes hear things and hear things, but there's got to come a time when it's going to start having to change. And we know many things, but there comes a time when we need to start to change, because we are now in the new season. We are now, behold, I do a new thing. Last week's Torah portion of Shemini was, I do a new thing. It's number 8, it's a new beginning. And from the time that we started, when we started Pesach, Father said, this is a new season. I'm taking you into a new season. I'm going to do a new thing with you. And therefore, with the new, you cannot put the new wine in an old wineskin, like my husband reminded me on Wednesday morning. If the Father wants to do a new thing, it means the old wine cannot be put in the new wineskin, which means we are going to have to start on a journey of changing our mindset, changing our emotions, changing our walk. Everything must start to come in line with Abba Yahuwah, because at the end of the day, we are either transforming from glory to glory, or otherwise we're becoming more wicked. Because the wicked will become more wicked. And those in the last days, says the book of Daniel, that shine, they will shine brighter. But those that are wicked will become more wicked. And we can see in the world right now how the wicked are becoming more wicked. And so we are going to start to look at this Torah portion reading, because when we get to Mazarat, the Mazara, what is the Mazara? What's Mazara? Ra, already in the Hebrew language, means evil. So everything to do with the Zaria and to do with Metzorah is going to be where we must understand that there could be evil within our lives that we cannot see. But it will manifest itself in our body in different ways. And so we start with verse 1, where we start in Leviticus chapter 12, and it says, "And Yahuwah spoke to Moshe, saying, speak to the children of Israel, saying, when a woman has conceived and has given birth to a male child, then she shall be unclean 7 days, as in the days of her monthly separation she's unclean. And on the 8th day, the flesh of his foreskin is circumcised." Now how interesting. How interesting that the priests themselves, the priests that are the ones that have to stand in the gap before the people of the Father in order to intercede, in order to offer the sacrifices for the Father, just a few chapters ago, were having to be able to be cleansed for 7 days. And if we go look in Leviticus chapter 8, From verse 33 it says, and do not go outside the door of the tent of appointment for 7 days, until the days of your ordination are completed, for he fills your hands for 7 days. And Yahweh has commanded to do, as he has done this day, to make atonement for you. And stay at the door of the tent of appointment day and night for 7 days. And you shall guard the duty of Yahuwah and not die. For so I have been commanded. And Aharon and his sons did all the words that Yahuwah had commanded by the hand of Moshe. So the whole of chapter 8 of Leviticus is where we see where Aharon is being set apart with his sons, the Levites. They were being set apart, and interesting, they were being put, even in verses Leviticus chapter 8 verses 9, it says they were putting a turban on their head, and there was a garment being put on them, and they were being set apart for the Father. They were being anointed with they were being cleansed with blood, they were being anointed with oil. And isn't it interesting that these priests were having to be able to do all of this because there was going to be a time that they were going to have to stand in the gap for the people, the nation of Israel, in their sin. And so, when we look and we see how our Messiah himself is the one who's had to go through the whole process of everything that his death and resurrection to be able to become our high priest now. Because we no longer have a temple. We can no longer come and offer our sacrifices at a temple in order to be able to have ourselves cleansed. We cannot go to a priest and go and offer our sacrifice. But praise the Father, we have a high priest. And that is why this is so significant when others started to show me the whole understanding here. Because look and see how everything here pertains to our Messiah. Because if we look in Luke 2, let's go to Luke 2. Stay with your hand in Leviticus 12 because we're going to go back there. But let's go to Luke chapter 2. And in Luke chapter 2, from verse 22, it says, and when the days of her cleansing, according to the Torah of Moshe, were complete, they brought him to Yerushalayim to present him to Yahuwah. So, let's go a little bit back from verses 19. And Miriam kept all these matters concerning them in her heart, and the shepherds returned boasting. Okay, verse 21. And when 8 days were completed for him to be circumcised, his name was called Yahushua, the name given by the messenger before he was conceived in the womb. Now, we saw in verse 3, in Leviticus chapter 12, verse 3, it says, and on the 8th day, the flesh of his foreskin is circumcised. So yeah, on the 8th day, Yahushua is being presented. And his name is being given. And you know what's interesting? In the land of Israel, it is still today a tradition, which I put my foot in. I didn't even know. Because there was a young man that I was like sort of, you know, walking a path with when I was there in Israel. Rami. And his wife was pregnant. And then the day that she gave birth, I phoned him to, you know, wish him all the best. And, you know, to really just, you know, bless him for the birth of his baby, for the little boy that had been born. And then I said, and what is his name? And he says, but you should know, Natalia, his name will only be given on the 8th day when he's going to be circumcised. And I thought, okay. So if I should have been this Jewish woman, I should have known that the name is going to be given on the 8th day when they circumcised. And yeah, exactly this, when I read the scripture, is interesting because this is exactly when Yahushua's name was given to him on the 8th day, as he was circumcised. And this morning, even when I was meditating and I was saying, Father, what are you trying to show me about this 8th day? And isn't it interesting, when we keep the feast, of tabernacles, there's 7 days we keep the feast, and then there's an eighth day. It's 8 days. And Father was showing me how we are going to have 7 years. So we got 7 days where the priest has been cleansed for 7 days. 7 is the number of divine perfection. So we are in the millennial of the 6,000 years. But then there's going to be a 1,000-year millennial reign. And then it's going to start the eighth day. And that eighth day is going to be the circumcision. And what is the circumcision going to be? It's when we are going to be severed completely from the circumcision of the flesh. Because when the circumcision of the flesh now, when Yeshua came to be our high priest, when Yeshua came to die and he resurrected, that circumcision is not just only the circumcision of the flesh, because the covenant that has been given was the covenant. What was the circumcision? The circumcision was the sign of the covenant. That's the circumcision. It's the sign of the covenant. Now, the covenant is not only a covenant made of the flesh. Because you see, when the covenant was done on Mount Sinai, in Exodus chapter 19, they entered into covenant with the Father. When the Torah was given, when the command was given, written on the tablets of their heart, that is when the covenant was made. That's the ketubah. That is when they entered into covenant with Abba Yahuwah. But they chose not to listen to that covenant. And because of that, Abba Yahuwah came, and what does he do? He gives us Yahushua Messiah. And as he gives us Yahushua Messiah, he's now the one who comes to become our high priest. He dies, he resurrects, becomes the high priest in the order of Melchizedek, and gives us the Ruach of Abba Yahuwah. That's now going to do what? Write Torah on the tablets of our heart. Because if we go look at Deuteronomy, let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 30. And we see what was Abba's plan from the beginning. In Deuteronomy 30 verse 6 it says, "And Yahuwah your Lord shall circumcise your heart and the heart of your seed to love Yahuwah." So the Father has wanted us to have circumcised hearts. Now, I am having to start here. Before we can go any further, we need to understand that everything about Caesarea is going to be about a circumcision, that we need to understand that the Father wants a circumcision of the heart. That is the way he's showing me. Before we can get to Metzorah, which is what comes out of the mouth, is going to contaminate us, because it's what resides in our hearts. And so at the end of the day, he's saying here clearly that he says in verse 6, "And Yahuwah your Lord shall circumcise your heart and the heart of your seed to love Yahuwah your Lord with all your heart and with all your being so that you might live." So we are to love him, but how do we love him? We show that we love him. He says, Yahushua speaking says in his word, "If you love me, you obey my commands." So how do we love him if yet we don't obey his commands? So, now he says in verse 7, "Yahuwah your Lord shall put all these curses on your enemies and on those who hate you, who persecute you. And you shall turn back and obey the voice of Yahuwah and do all his commands, which I command you today. And Yahuwah your Lord shall make you have excess in all your work of your hand, in the fruit of your body, in the fruit of your livestock, in the fruit of your ground of you, for good. For Yahuwah turns back to rejoice over you for good as you rejoice over your fathers. If you obey the voice of Yahuwah your Lord to guard his commands and his laws which are written in this book of the Torah. If you turn back to Yahuwah, your Lua, with all your heart and with all your being, for For this command which I am commanding you today, it is not too hard for you, nor is it far off. Why is it not too hard for us today? Why is it not far off? Because Yeshua is the one that has come and fulfilled Torah and became Torah in the flesh so that we may ourselves walk this Torah fully ourselves. So when the Father showed me the eighth day, He's showing me that there's an eighth day of when we are going to reign and rule with Him for eternity. Not the millennial reign of the 7,000, which is the 1,000-year millennial reign, but the eighth day is the new beginning, the new day, the new dawn of the eighth day, which is going to be when we will live with Him forever, where the enemy will have been thrown in the lake of fire, where there will be no more need to circumcise our hearts, because we will be fully in love with Abba Yahuwah, and we will be His people, and we will live in the new Jerusalem forever to be with Him. That will be an eighth day, when we will be a people that will no longer be tormented by a Hasatan, because he will have been bound forever. Because remember, in the 1,000-year millennial reign, he's bound for 1,000 years, and after 1,000 years, he's released again. And then he comes to tempt us again. And then after that, he will be thrown in the lake of fire. And then you're going to have an eighth day where you will be circumcised forever to be with your King. So, throughout this time, our hearts are needing to be circumcised constantly. Let's look at Jeremiah 4 verse 4. So, if we go look at Jeremiah 4 verse 4, it says a very similar scripture. Jeremiah 4 verse 4 says, "Circumcise yourselves unto Yahuwah, and take away the foreskin of your hearts, you men of Yehudah and inhabitants of Jerusalem, lest my wrath come forth like fire and burn, with none to quench it because of the evil of your deeds." And this is the message that I need to preach today, because the Father is wanting us to circumcise our hearts, because if not, we are being weighed in scales, and we are going to have His judgments come upon us if our hearts are not circumcised. Because we need to understand, Father has given us, and this was the message that the Father gave me on Monday of this week. Father gave me a message to say, "My child, I'm giving you this time of Shavuot, for you to, as you count in the Omer, every day, I'm wanting you to come before me, and I'm wanting you to be able to allow me to do introspection, continue to do introspection within your heart, for me to be able to see what is there, so that I can bring it, for me to be able to reveal to you what is there, for you to be able to bring it before me." You know, Father is so faithful. Because, you know, before His feasts, He gives us time. That before we come and enter His feasts, He gives us time for us to do introspection in our lives before a feast. Now let's look at this. At Passover, He tells us to start removing the leaven from our houses. Now as we remove the physical leaven from our houses, we start to remove the leaven from our hearts. To say, what is the sin that is still within my heart? So it's a time of introspection. And then we come to Passover, and then we still have the Feast of Unleavened Bread for another 7 days, where we're looking at this heart of ours. And now we are busy with counting of the Omer, leading up to another harvest. And this harvest is coming at Shavuot. And this is again a time that the Father is still giving us before bringing in this harvest, to really take time to be able to look within our hearts and see, are we still maybe have things there that have not been dealt with? The Father is so gracious that He continues to give us time. And this is what He was showing me on Monday. that we are being weighed in scales, and the Father is continually having to bring our hearts before us to see what is residing there. And like I've been saying to you guys, me, it's been for a while, for a long time. And man, I stumble and I fall, and praise the Father for every stumbling and falling, because if I don't stumble and I don't fall, I cannot see my sin. So embrace your difficulties, embrace your hurdles that you've got to go through. Don't see it as bad, see it as good, because we learn from it. We learn from it. And so, as we have to go through this time, we're doing introspection. Then we come to Shavuot. After Shavuot, just before we enter into Yom Teruah, we go through 30 days from the first of the month of Elul, for 30 days before we come to Yom Teruah. For 30 days from the first day of the month of Elul, we do again another 30 days of introspection before Yom Teruah. So again we start to check our hearts. And then we have Yom Kippur, which is a day of total set-apartness, which is a day of total fasting, which is a day of total cleansing before we can come into tabernacles. How faithful is the Father? How much introspection does He want us to do? Because you see, He needs us to understand that it's the leprosy that is in our heart, in our lives, that is keeping us captive and bound. And the leprosy is what dwells within our hearts that we cannot see. It manifests itself in many ways in our body. From the heart flows many things. And this is what we need to look at. And so we look and we see, as we continue to look and we see in Deuteronomy now 36, because if we're looking at the heart and we're looking at this covenant and we're looking at what Yahushua has done, and we're looking at Yahushua was even as a baby dedicated. He came and He was dedicated. Mary came to the temple 7 days. She had to come. She had to come and offer Him up, because let's go back to Luke chapter 2 where we can quickly read this. So Luke chapter 2 verse 21, and when 8 days were completed for Him to be circumcised, His name was called Yahushua, the name given by the messenger before He was conceived in the womb. And when the days of her cleansing, according to the Torah of Moshe, were completed, they brought Him to Jerusalem to present Him to Yahuwah. So what was the days of that cleansing? Let's go and look and see, because if we go to Leviticus chapter 12, we will understand what the days of the cleansing is. The days of the cleansing, and she remains in the blood of her cleansing 33 days. She does not touch whatever is set apart, and she does not come into the set apart place until the days of her cleansing are complete. So Mary comes when her days of complete, or her days of her cleansing are complete, which is the 33 days. She comes, and listen to what happens. And as it has been written in the Torah of Yahuwah, every male who opens the womb shall be called set apart to Yahuwah, and to give an offering according to what is said in the Torah of Yahuwah, a pair of turtle doves or 2 young pigeons. And see, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Shimon. And this man was righteous and dedicated, looking for the comforting of Israel, and the set-apart spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the set-apart spirit that he would not see death before he sees the Messiah of Yahuwah. And he came in the spirit into the set-apart place, and as the parents brought in the child, Yahushua, to do for him according to the usual practice of the Torah, then he took him up in his arms and blessed Eloah and said, "Now let your servant go in peace, O Master, according to your word, for my eyes have seen your deliverance, which you have prepared before the face of all the peoples." Now how interesting. After the 33 days, she comes and she offers Yahushua, according to what is written in Torah. How old was Yahushua when he died? 33 years of age. He dies at the age of 33. And how interesting it is that he comes at that age. And now, exactly what Simon says, he becomes the deliverer at the age of 33. which is exactly the amount of days that she's having to be set apart, 33 days for a male. He dies at the age of 33 so that he can become the fullness of the atonement of the blood to be able to come and cleanse us on the day that he dies on that at the stake for us. And then the father shows me even more. And the father says, but my child, take the 33 days and take the 7 days and add it together. It's a total of 40 days. So how many days did Yahushua go into the wilderness after he is mikvahed, after he is cleansed with water? Because Moses himself goes into the ark and for 40 days and 40 nights it rains upon the earth, and the waters of the deep come up and it rains upon the earth to bring the cleansing on the earth for what has just been destroyed. The water comes to cleanse. 40 days and 40 nights. 40 years that the Israelites are in the desert, in the wilderness, and they're being tested 40 years. And Yah, we see Yahushua goes into the wilderness for 40 days. And what are the tests that he has to undergo in the wilderness? I do not have time to go into all those tests now, but I do have a teaching on the YouTube channel on the tests in the wilderness, which is very, very powerful because these are the tests that we are undergoing right now. It's three basic tests. The first test is the test of self-sufficiency. So you see within our hearts, what is the thing? Money becomes the issue. That's what we have to be able to undergo. Can we trust Him in our financial ways? Can we trust Him? Or will we go and do wicked things in our heart in order to be able to do what we can for financial gain? Then it's the test of the spectacular. Now throw yourself from this ledge. Throw yourself off here and the angels will come and catch you. So as you start to raise up, do you start to elate yourself as you being spectacular now? Or do you put Abba Yahuwah to the test? Oh no, you know what? I walk with the Father, so therefore I can take this V thing, I can take this jazz thing, it's okay because He's going to protect me. That's putting Him to the test. So we become arrogant in our walk with Him. We become puffed up. We become arrogant. And these are all the things that we need to look at in the Torah portion reading, because at the end of the day, it's in our arrogance that we think we stand when we're going to fall. Because at the end of the day, let me just quickly go there. Because my Father's just giving me a scripture that's coming to mind in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And it says, no trial, 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verses 13 says, no trial has overtaken you. Okay, so let's see. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, you can go read the whole of 1 Corinthians chapter 10. It's a very powerful scripture, especially from 10 to verses 13, which is where I'm gonna read verses 11 to 13. But go and read 1 Corinthians chapter 10, because all the tests that they underwent in the wilderness was for the Father to be able to reveal what was in their hearts. That's what He said in Deuteronomy chapter 8. I tested you in the wilderness to reveal what's in your hearts. So look at what He says. So He says, and all these came upon them as examples, and they were written as warnings to us, on whom the ends of the ages have come, so that he who thinks he stands, let him take heed lest he fall. No trial has overtaken you except such as is common to man. And Eloah is trustworthy, who shall not allow you to be trialed beyond what you are able, but with the trial shall also make the way of escape, enabling you to bear it. So even in that trial, He's able to be able to bring that trial, to be able to help you to bear it, so that you may come to a place where He will always give you a way of escape. You have choices, remember. You have a choice to make. You choose life or you choose death. If you're going to choose life, you will get the deliverance. If you're going to choose death, you are going to stay in the destruction that's going to come your way. So we have choices to make. And these were the choices that was presenting me in this week. I was either going to humble or I was going to be able to continue to have destruction coming my way. So we need to understand that the Father brings these things across our path, because in Deuteronomy, let's quickly go there, Deuteronomy chapter 8, he's birthing his own message, I told you. I don't know what all's going to come out of this, but he's going to birth a message, praise the Father, because he knows what he wants to say. I will just preach it. So he says, from Deuteronomy chapter 8 from verse 1, God to do every command which I command you today, that you might live and shall increase and go in and shall possess the land of which Yahuwah swore to your fathers. So do we want to be those that can possess the land, the promised land? Can we be those that may be able to enter into an ark in the time that we need to enter into this ark in this time now? Because there's going to be much destruction coming upon the earth, but we need to be those that enter into an ark. But how can we enter into an ark? The ark that we need to enter in is Abba Yahuwah's presence dwelling within our hearts. But if our hearts are filled with wickedness, how can He inhabit? And you shall remember that Yahuwah your Lord led you all the way these 40 years in the wilderness to humble you, to prove you, to know what is in your heart, whether you will guard His commands or not. He humbled you and let you suffer hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, to make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of Abba Yahuwah. And so when I do the tests in the wilderness, when the Father got me to do the tests in the wilderness, and Yahushua's tests in the wilderness that he had to undergo for 40 days, those tests are lined up to the tests that the Israelites underwent in the wilderness. So that every one of those tests he has already overcome, so that we have no excuse, because we have a high priest that at the age of 33 was sacrificed for us, and his blood was shed, so that the blood that had to, the woman that gave birth to that baby, for those 33 days of the uncleanliness, Yahushua comes and he fulfills by becoming the high priest for us, to say, I fulfilled everything, right down to the last letter and to the last dotting of an I and the last crossing of a T in this Torah. And I stand in awe of everything that he has done. And so we need to understand that the reason why we read the Torah is so that we can more and more see our Messiah in the Torah. As we read the scriptures in the renewed covenant, we start to understand that which Yahushua did in the renewed covenant has already been done in the foundational covenant. I don't call it an Old Testament. I call it a foundational covenant, because this is the foundational covenant. So if we go to now Ezekiel, let's go to Ezekiel 36. Because I'm giving an overview here of the things that the priest would have to do. The priest would have to sprinkle the blood. The priest would have to sprinkle the water. The priest would have to do these things. Now look and see, what is it that is being spoken? Listen to what the Father does, because he wants a renewed heart. He wants a new heart. So everything about these offerings that are being done, everything about this Torah portion is about the fact that these lepers that are coming before him, they've got a sickness in their bodies. But where's the sickness coming from? And that is what we're going to look at today. So he says in Ezekiel 36 from verses 25. Let's read from verse 23. And I shall set apart my great name, which has been profaned among the nations, which you have profaned in their midst. And the nations shall know that I am Yahuwah, declares the Master Yahuwah, when I am set apart in you before their eyes. And I shall take you from among the nations, and I shall gather you out of all the lands, and I shall bring you into your own land. So the Father wants to bring us into that land. We, as the lost tribes of the house of Israel, are being equipped, are being prepared to finally be able to come back to our own land, to reign and rule with Messiah Yeshua in the land of Eretz Israel. And listen to what he says in verse 25. And I shall sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean. So what did the Father do? Even with when he had to destroy the world the way it was before. 40 days raining to cleanse the land. And I shall sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your filthiness, and from all your idols I cleanse you. And I shall give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. And I shall take the heart of stone out of your flesh, and I shall give you a heart of flesh. So what does he want to do? He wants to give us a new circumcised heart, not just the circumcision of the physical flesh, where a man would have to circumcise his physical flesh. Yeshua had his physical flesh circumcised as a young boy at the age of at 8 days of existence, because that was the sign of the covenant. But the covenant that he's doing with us now is a circumcision of our hearts, not just a circumcision of a physical flesh, where the man was being able to circumcise the physical flesh, but now it's a circumcision of the flesh and of the heart. So it's our body that must come in line, and it's our heart that must come in line. So we women do not have a physical circumcision of flesh, because we don't have those genital parts, but we have to circumcise our flesh man, not just our soul man, because our flesh man must come in line. And he says, and you shall, and he says, and I will put my spirit within you, and I shall cause you to walk in my laws and guard my right rulings and shall do them. And look what he says, and you shall dwell in the land that I gave your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I shall be your Lord. And I shall save you from all your uncleannesses. And I shall call for the grain and increase it, and I shall bring no scarcity of food upon you. So there's our protection in the days that are going to go ahead, if we truly have a circumcision of heart. And that's why the Father is saying, this was the word he said to me on Monday. My child, you need to speak to my people. And little did I know that as I was just preaching the message, as I was already just sharing with Elsie, the word that the Father had spoken to me on Monday, that I was going to have a test come my way. That I was going to fail with flying colors. Oh, for sure. But you know what? If there's no test, there can be no testimony. And if I do not go through the tests, I cannot overcome. I cannot always see how the serpent comes my way. But praise the Father, because the Ruach of Yahuwah will work on our behalf. The Ruach of Yahuwah will speak on our behalf. And the Ruach of Yahuwah is going to come to convict the heart of the sin that is there, to be able to bring you to repentance, so that you may be able to come and operate and walk in repentance. It doesn't just help you to speak repentance. You need to walk repentance. It's easy to say, oh, you know what? I forgive. No, I forgive my brother. I forgive my brother. But are you willing to go and say you're sorry to your brother? Are you willing to pick up the phone and make right with your brother? Are you willing to go to your brother face to face and make right with your brother? No, you see, it's easier to speak behind my brother's back. It's easy to be able to go and break down my brother. And this is what we do. And this is the Lashon Hara. And this is the Metzora that we are going to have to look at today. Because within us resides much wickedness. And this must stop. And this is the place that I got to on Tuesday night. Then I said, Father, it is enough. And if it wasn't for the fact that I had to write a physical test in this, of where it's been weeks and weeks of barricading of words going backwards and forwards by not just myself, but many people, that's just aggravating the situation. And if we would just do what the Bible says we ought to do, then it will all just stop in its tracks. Because the enemy's goal is to divide. The enemy's goal is to destroy. The enemy's goal is to put his venom within you. And the venom is the venom of bitterness, hatred, unforgiveness. And to be able to stand and feel, woe is me. Look at what has been done to me. I am the victim of a thing. But you see, while you play the victim, you need to understand that the enemy is still playing his game with you. And he allows you to continue to meditate things in your mind. And the more you meditate things in your mind, the worse it becomes, because out of the abundance of our thoughts become our words. Our words become our actions. Our actions become our destiny. What have we thought yesterday that we spoke today that we're going to become tomorrow? I have been preaching this for years. My goodness, since just about I got saved, this has been a revelation to me. There was a time in my office that I would, between us, when I used to run my office, between us, because we were all Christian that used to work together, we were not allowed to say negative words. And the minute we spoke something negative, we had to repent. But you know, then we want to take the prosperity gospel and we want to throw a lot of things out. And then we come into this movement and then we tend to forget the few things that now we think we are so holy and we think we've arrived, because now we're keeping a bunch of commands that now those things don't apply. You know, it's the Father's bringing us back to ground zero. Well, me anyway. Maybe it's not for you. Maybe this is just for me. He's bringing me back to ground zero. Because we need to understand that there is too much going on, and brother is going to turn against brother in these last days. And when brother is going to turn against brother, how are you going to behave when brother turns against brother? Because if we are called to be priests, there can be no malice in our heart. How do we come? Why did they have to be cleansed for 7 days? Why did they have to stay in that Mishkan for 7 days? Why did they have to stay in the presence of the Father for 7 days? So that the Father's presence could come and reside in their hearts and make sure that it comes and penetrates in their heart, so that when they offer those sacrifices and whatever the sin is that the people is coming to be able to speak to you as the priest, you are not going to go and speak it out to someone else. You are going to offer the sacrifice. So if someone is going to come and bear their heart to you, and someone's going to come and share their heart with you, and they wanting to be able to get you, to be able to help them, they don't expect you to go and share it with everybody else. Now imagine if the priests were doing that. But this is what we as the priests are doing today. And you know what? We are all guilty as charged. And that is why we need to spend time in His presence. And that is why we need to spend time with Him. Because the more we are filled with Him, the less we have of ourselves. And the more we are going to operate as He wants us to operate. And the less the enemy is going to get a hold of us. Because that is why at the end of Passover, when it came to after the 7 days of when we had to be able to finish the feast of unleavened bread, the Father had us to be able to come to a place of saying, just like Yehoshua, the high priest, was standing before Hasatan, Hasatan accusing him before the Father. And this is what is going on right now. Hasatan is accusing so many of his children before the Father. And why is he doing that? Because we are guilty of our own sin. And that is why we have a high priest. We have a high priest who we can go to and say, Father, The Bible says we can confess our sin to one another. But if you cannot confess it to a brother because maybe you cannot trust the brother, then you have a high priest that you can confess it to. So that he may be the one to be able to come and do the work that needs to be done. And then we pray and we ask the Father. Many times the Father reveals things to us, not because we are supposed to go and tell somebody else, but because the Father wants to reveal it to us so that we may be able to be the priest and intercede. So let us go and look and see. Because if we go look at Hebrews, I think it's in Hebrews chapter 5. He's just reminding me of the scripture. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 5. For every priest taken from among men, Hebrews chapter 5 verse 1. For every priest taken from among men is appointed on behalf of men in matters relating to Eloah, to offer both gifts and offerings for sins, being able to have a measure of feeling for those not knowing and being led astray. Since he himself is also surrounded by weakness. There you go. Okay, let's read it again. For every priest taken from among men is appointed on behalf of men in the matters relating to Eloah. So if the Father calls us as an intercessor to be able to come and to be able to stand before the Father on matters relating to the thing that he's maybe going to show you, and we are going to come, and it says, to offer both gifts and offerings for sins. So the priest had to come and offer offerings and sin offerings and all these gifts that they were offering before the Father on behalf of the people, for the sins of the people. Now we cannot do that today. But we offer our prayers as supplication. Being able to have a measure of feeling. So now listen carefully why you are not to pray your things away and why you are to go through what the Father wants you to go through for you to understand. Because listen to what he says, being able to have a measure of feeling for those not knowing and being led astray, since he himself is also surrounded by weakness. So guess what? The same priest that is interceding for others is just as weak as that other person, because he too is able to fall into the same sin. So be careful that we point our finger thinking, oh, I'm so righteous in that area and this person so sinful in that area, because in the very same area that you think you're righteous standing there, you will fall too. Because we are all weak in our flesh. And that is why that was the prophetic word that the Father gave me at Pesach, to say, acknowledge your weaknesses, stay in your weaknesses, know your weaknesses, because it's when you are weak, I am strong. Stay humble before me, stay in your weaknesses before me. I'm not saying stay in your weaknesses in staying in your sin. I'm saying stay in your weaknesses in acknowledging your sin and knowing, Father, I have this thing inside of me, but please, I need your help. I mean, if we look and see, Abraham was not perfect. He lied twice. Yet Father used him to be able to pray for the one whom he had lied to. If we look at Moses never entered in because he struck a rock. Yet he was called the most humble man before the Father. So we need to understand that the Father is wanting us to come to a place of becoming a priest before him. But for us to become that priest, we need to first deal with what is in our hearts. And he says, on account of this, verse 3, on account of this, he has to offer for sins, as for the people, so also for himself. And no one obtains this esteem for himself, but he who is called by Eloah, even as Aaron also was. So there are these that the Father is calling in this day to be able to stand, to be able to intercede on behalf of others. So also Messiah did not extol himself to become high priest, but it was he who said to him, you are my son, today I have brought you forth. And he also says in another place, you are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek, who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and petitions with strong crying and tears to him, who was able to save him from death and was hurt because of his reverent fear? Are we able to offer up petitions on behalf of those that we may bring before the Father? Now listen to what it says here. Though being a son, he learned obedience by what he suffered. Praise the Father. That is why, praise the Father, that's why I thank the Father for every trial and for every test. And I thank the Father for when I have to go through suffering. Why? Because it is birthing within me the obedience that I need in order to come to be able to come out on the other side and say, thank you, Father, for what you have done. Because this has been a valuable lesson in my life. I don't want to write this test again. I really, really don't. I want to learn from this one. And even though I might write it again, let me not write it for as long as I wrote this one. Let it be shorter accounts until eventually I can overcome fully. And having been perfected, now look at this. Having been perfected, he became a causer of everlasting deliverance to all those obeying him. So guess what? As you go through that area of your difficulty, as you go through that area of where you have to overcome that thing in your life, guess what? You become perfected in that area because, let me tell you, if you go through it enough, and you hate that thing enough until you overcome from it, like people who have been delivered from drugs, people that have been delivered from, say for example, pornography or whatever it is. They hate that sin enough to be able to become a deliverer for others that find themselves in that same sin. So he says, he became a causer of everlasting deliverance to all those obeying him. So as we go through the things that we have to go through, we can then become a deliverer for others in that area to say, listen, you know what, I also had this problem. I also had this problem in my life. But you know what, Father has helped me to overcome. Let me help you. Let me pray with you. You become the deliverer for that person that finds himself in that place of sin. And so what is this place that the Father is wanting us to look at today? What is this place? We're looking at the heart. We're looking at the issues of our heart. Because why? Because everything that we look at, we're not going to go, I'm not going to read the whole Torah portion because, you know, as you read it, you might not even understand. I mean, you know what, we're reading all of this and it talks about how our flesh is going to appear and they're going to be unclean and there were these lepers. And now we think there's no lepers in this day because there's no leprosy in this day. Well, I tell you something. If you've got a skin rash, if you've got skin problems, you better be going a little bit deep and asking the Father, what is your skin problem? Because your skin problem is coming from a manifestation of what comes from the heart. And if you really start to be able to study, when you really look at, I mean, I remember Henry Wright has a book that, I just can't remember the name right now. It's got to do with the illnesses that you have within you. And I know that even when I was going through my cancer, when I had to look and see the cancer that I had, the root of it was because of self-hate. And therefore, I had to go deep in repentance to stand before the Father and look and see what is it that is in my heart that is there, that is bringing this about, because the root, there's a root that is there. It's called the more excellent way. That's it. Elsie just looked it up for me. The more excellent way. And that book really helped me to be able to look and see. Because you know what? Sometimes we have got, you know what? Like I said, we might not kill a person. You know, when we look at, we go right back. Let's go right to the beginning in Genesis. When Cain killed Abel, what did he do? He hated his brother in his heart. What did the Father say? Now, if you so much as hate your brother in your heart, you've already committed murder. So now, he doesn't just say, if you just murder a person, you've committed murder. He says, if you so much as hate your brother in your heart. And how do we murder somebody? If you If someone does something against you, and then they speak up against you, and then they go and they continue to speak up against you, and then they make sure they tell everybody because of a sin or whatever it is, or whatever it is, you have to go and look and see. At the end of the day, you will murder that person by the words that you speak. The words that you speak will bring death in that person's life. You cannot speak evil things over people. It will bring a leprosy on your skin. And then, Father this morning said to me, my child, don't just take it in speaking. There's many people that will speak, but then there are those that think. It's not just the speaking of the words, it's the thinking of the words. Because there are those that might not speak the words. They might look at the person and they might not say a single thing out of their mouths. But let me tell you something. Every time they're meditating on that evil thought in their mind, and they keep meditating on that evil thought in their mind, and that evil, wicked thing that is within us will manifest itself one way or the other. And so the leprosy that we develop is because of the lashon hara, that we do not know how to bite our tongue. And that is why we need to understand that this is an evil leprosy that is coming upon the body of Messiah right now. And this has killed ministries. It's destroyed people's lives. It's caused people that would be serving the Father, wholeheartedly serving the Father, and then this evil comes. Because it's ra, it's metzora. Metzora, ra is evil. And it brings a leprosy that it's, the enemy can actually bind that person to such a degree that that person goes into bitterness, it goes into anger, it goes into unforgiveness. And these are the things that the Father is dealing with us now in this hour. And so let's go look at Matthew chapter 5. Because I want to just share, as we start to wind down, a message. What is it that the Father is trying to tell us in the hour that we're in? Because there are many of us that might be doing all the commands of the Father, but we are falling short in other areas of our lives. And that is why we need to understand that the Father wants to bring us into a place. The Father wants to bring us into a place of where we truly can do introspection now. If it's things that come from your childhood, you need to deal with it. You can't keep making excuses and say, oh, you know what, because my mother rejected me and my father rejected me, therefore I have this pain, and because of my pain I lash out or whatever. We can't keep making excuses, because Yeshua has paid the price. He has given his life. He is the living Torah that has walked it out. And if we say that we keep Torah and we continue to do this, then we are falling short of Torah. Because we are supposed to be becoming the priests that are supposed to be cleansing ourselves so that Father can start using us in the Holy of Holies to be able to stand in the gap for His people. And that is why He wants an ark that can carry His presence. But how is He going to have an ark that carries His presence when we are still filled with so much self within us? And this is the things He's been showing me. So, let's look at Matthew chapter 15, from verses 7. He says, hypocrites, Yeshua rightly prophesied about you, saying, this people draw near to me with their mouth and respect me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. So how many people are worshipping him with their mouths, worshipping him with all their outward manifestations? They do all these outward manifestations for the Father, but yet their hearts are far from him. But in vain they worship me, teaching as teaching the commandments of men. So you see, if we are going to be a people that are just going to teach the people the commandments of men and we don't live it, then what are we? We are going to be a person that is going to land up becoming a hypocrite. And you know what? That is one of the things that I stood before the Father and I said, Father, on Tuesday night I stood before him and I said, Father, I did not want to be a hypocrite. If you want me to preach this word, I need to live this word. Even if it costs me in my flesh. Even if right now everything within me doesn't want to do this which I want to do. And it comes back to the words that I keep saying. And I had to live those words out myself. It's not who's right, it's not who's wrong, it's who humbles. And calling the crowd near, he said to them, hear and understand. Not that which goes into the mouth defiles the man, but that which comes out of the mouth, this defiles the man. So you see, we can either be an instrument to be able to be used by the Father. Our mouths are either going to be used by the Father as an instrument that's going to be able to bring life, or we can become an instrument of the Father to be able to be one that's going to bring death. The choice is ours. And you know, if there's one thing that I truly had to be able to come and cry out to the Father in this week myself, was, you know, when you are a mouthpiece for the Father, like I am a mouthpiece for the Father, my mouth is either going to be used for the glory and the honor of his name in good, or that I am going to allow the enemy to get the better of me so that my mouth can be used for destruction. And how much destruction will that bring? And if there's anything that has put the fear of Abba Yahuwah within me, I have understood. And if we would just get the fear of Abba Yahuwah within us, I think we would operate very differently. And I think if the Father would seriously bring leprosy upon us like he did in the days of old, like Miriam when she spoke up against Moses and she got leprosy upon her body, then I tell you something. I think we would refrain, and I think the fear of Yahuwah would be upon us, and we would refrain from the things that we do. And Miriam was speaking up against the servant of the Most High. Irrespective of whether that servant was right or wrong, he's still a servant of the Most High. Because she did not agree with something in his life. And she got leprosy. And then Moshe had to intercede for her, in order for the Father to have mercy and the leprosy be taken off her. And isn't it interesting? When they had leprosy, when they first had to detect it, they had to go outside the camp for 7 days. Just like the priest had to go for 7 days and stay in the presence of the Father. And I think when there's things going on in our lives, we should refrain for 7 days. And come aside and seek the Father for 7 days. To be able to allow him to be able to come and help us in our hearts to be able to come right. That is just how I was seeing it this morning. I said, Father, next time I have an episode that's going to come in my way, I'm going to refrain myself for 7 days and go and seek your face And let you be the one to be able to come and cleanse me, that I can then stand before you, and that you can come and cleanse me. So his taught ones, verse 12 says, and his taught ones came and said to him, do you know that the Pharisees stumble when they heard this word? But he answering said, every plant which my heavenly Father has not planted shall be uprooted. Leave them alone. They are blind leaders of the blind, and if the blind leads the blind, both shall fall into a ditch. And Kepha answering said to him, explain this parable to us. And Yahushua said, are you still without understanding? Do you not understand that whatever enters into the mouth goes into the stomach and it casts out in the sewer? Now I want you to understand, nowhere was Yahushua speaking this word to be able to make food that we eat clean. I make that very clear today. Nowhere. He's speaking about the fact that if you really go look at the whole account, the disciples were eating with hands that were not washed. And now, they were complaining and saying, why do your disciples not wash their hands? Because that was the custom and the tradition that they had to do. They had to wash their hands before they went to eat. And he's saying, it's not with dirty hands that's going to defile you, because that's going to go into the stomach. But it's what's going to come out of your mouth. Now listen to what he says in verses 18. But what comes out of the mouth comes from the heart, and these defile the man. So what is it that's defiling us? It's what's coming out of the mouth. But what starts, what comes out of the mouth, it starts with a thought. So the enemy plants a thought. The enemy starts to plant the thought, oh, this one did this to me, and that one did this to me, and this one did this, and this one did that, and then you don't leave it there. No, now you need to be able to go further. For out of the heart comes forth wicked reasonings, murders. So you see, murders. We murder the people with our hearts. Adulteries, whorings, thefts, false witnessing, lies, slanderers. These defile the man. But to eat with unwashed hands does not defile the man. There, he brings it into perspective. To eat with unclean hands is not what's going to defile a man. So he was not talking about food being clean all of a sudden now. And so, when this week, on Monday, when he told me, my child, the remainder of this time, and this is when he spoke to me, Monday was 40 days left of the counting of the Omer. And the Father said, in these 40 days, I want you to enter into a fast of where you come and you start to fast before me. And I need you to start to clean up your thoughts, and I need you to start to clean up your heart. I need you to detox your mind. I need you to detox your heart. I need you to detox your body. So, it's not just a fast where we fast food. It's a fast where you've got to fast your thoughts. It's a fast where you're going to fast what's in your heart. It's a fast where you're going to start fasting before the Father and saying, show me those evil thoughts that are going to start coming out of my mouth, because they're going to go into my heart. You see, if you snuff it out of the mind straight away, it doesn't go into the heart. You've got to deal with it in your mind first before it starts to bear root in your heart. So when the thought starts to come, you better get rid of that thought before it bears root. Because the thought bears a root in your heart. And by the time it bears root in your heart, eventually your mouth is going to speak it. And eventually that's what's going to come into your life. And so that is why the Father is wanting us to be able to start to cleanse our thoughts. If there's things that people do that you do not agree with, then you go and you pray to the Father. Unless the Father tells you, let's go to Matthew chapter 5. Now look at what Matthew chapter 5 says. In Matthew chapter 5 it says, okay, Matthew chapter 5 from verse 21, it says, you heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment. But I say to you, that whoever is wroth, angry with his brother, without a cause, shall be liable to judgment. And whoever says to his brother, rocha,
You
idiot, you stupid, calling them names, shall be liable to the Sanhedrin. And whoever says you fool shall be liable to the fire of Gehinnom. If then you bring your gift to the slaughter place. Now, this is you speaking about those issues that are going on in your heart. So if you're going to bring your gift to the slaughter place, and there remember that your brother holds whatever against you, not you holding something against your brother. If you remember your brother's holding something against you, so you know that your brother is holding something against you. Leave your gift there before the slaughter place and go first make peace with your brother and then come and offer your gift. So if you know, so if you are sitting there and you know that your brother's upset with you and you know that your brother is upset because you've done your brother wrong, then you cannot come and offer your sacrifice at the table. You cannot come and take communion at the table of the Father. You've got to go make right with your brother. You've got to bring peace. Because this is what it says in Matthew chapter 15. Matthew chapter 18. This is the scripture the Father gave me. Matthew chapter 18 verses 15. If your brother sins against you, go and convict him between you and him alone. Not go and publicize it to everybody. If your brother sins against you, go and convict him between you and him alone. If he hears you, you have gained your brother. So you go to your brother and you say, look, what you have done is not right. And you try and resolve it with your brother. If he does not hear, take with you one or two more. Not the whole congregation. One or two witnesses. By the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word might be established. And if he refuses to hear them, say it to the assembly. So only when he refuses to accept it, then you say it to the assembly. Let him be to you like the nations and a tax collector. Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be having been loosed in heaven. And you see, this is why we can preach many things, we can teach many things, but it's time we start to teach the things that is written in this word of ours. Because it's easy to be able to say, but I'm following Torah. But if there's things going on, and these things are going backwards and forwards, go and make right with your brother before you offer the sacrifice at the Father. And you know how many times the Father's told me, go and make right with your brother, because your brother's holding something against you. I said, but Father, I'm not the one who did wrong. It's not the one who did wrong. It's not the one who does right. It's the one who humbles. Go and make right with your brother. And this is something that I have had to go back to. How many churches, how many places to go and say, I'm sorry, Father. I'm sorry for what I've done. I'm sorry. And this is what the Father is wanting us to do. To be able to move forward into the deeper things that the Father's got for us to do, we need to move forward. And so, if we look in chapter 18, it talks about, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but in chapter 18, it talks about if we do not forgive our brother their transgressions, it talks about a man that comes before the Father. So if you look and see verse 23, Matthew chapter 18, verse 23. So it says, verse 23, because of this, the reign of heaven is like a certain man, a sovereign who wishes to settle accounts with his servants. And when he has begun to settle, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. But as he was unable to pay, his master commanded that he be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and payment to be made. Then the servant fell down before him, saying, Master, have patience with me, and I shall pay you all. And the master of that servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave him the debt. And that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, pay me what you owe. Then his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, have patience with me, and I shall pay you all. But he would not, and went and threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. And when his fellow servants saw what had been done, they were deeply grieved and came and reported to their master all that had taken place. Then the master called him and said to him, wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt, seeing you begged me. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, as I also had compassion on you? And his servant was wroth and delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due to him. So also my Father shall do to you if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses. Listen to what it says. So also my Father shall do to you if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses. And you know what he does? He will send out the tormentors. Says verse 34, and the master was wroth and delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due to him. He will send the torturers, the tormentors, to torment us that we will have no peace and we will have no rest in our body because of the things that we are doing. So this is a hard word, but this is the word that I'm not just preaching here today. I stand before you as one who has had to humble and repent because I have not lived this word. And I can come before the Father today, and I have come before the Father in this week from when he started with me already on Monday and say, Abba, have mercy, my King. For truly, I have sinned in many ways. And you see, even as Nahum, if we are going to close off as we go to 2 Kings, Naaman comes to the prophets. And this is a lesson here for all of us. And Naaman came to the prophets. And Elisha sent a messenger to him. Elisha didn't go out. Because if this man had leprosy, Elisha would have defiled himself. Do you understand? He's a prophet of the Father, was set apart to the Father, and he did not want to defile himself. And what does Elisha say? Elisha sent a messenger to him saying, go and you shall wash 7 times in the Jordan, that your flesh might be restored to you and be clean. Just like that 7 days that they had to be set apart. He told him, go and wash in the river 7 times. We need to be washed. He had to go dip himself. But Naaman became wroth and went away and said, see, I said to myself, he would certainly come out to me and stand and call on the name of Yahweh his Elohim and wave his hand over the place and recover the leprosy. So see, sometimes the Father will bring someone in your life to be able to speak something, but you don't want to listen. And you continue. And you get upset and you get angry. Like Naaman did. People want to obey. They want the healing, but they don't want the obedience part. They want to walk in the fullness of the glory, but they don't want the obedience part. The prophet is telling him, go and cleanse yourself 7 times in the river. But because the prophet didn't appear before him, that wasn't good enough for him. And his servant came near and spoke to him and said, my father, if the prophet has spoken to you a great matter, would you not have done it? How much more then, when he says to you, wash and be clean? Then he went down and dipped 7 times in the Jordan according to the word of the man of Elohim, and his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child. And he was clean. And he returned to the man of Elohim, he and all his company, and came and stood before him and said, see, now I know that there is no Elohim in all the earth except in Israel. And now please take a gift from your servant. And you know, We must understand in this, you know, this Torah portion reading, it only reads to 5:19. But if we actually read to the whole of the end, how sad it was, because when he wanted to give the gift to Naaman's servant, well, to Elisha, Elisha said no. But the servant then decided he's going to go and, you know, go and get the gift. And in turn, the leprosy that was on Naaman then comes on him, on the servant of Elisha. So there are those that walk with the servants of the Father, that walk, and then sometimes they turn against the servants of the Father themselves. And we need to be very careful, because in this story alone, there is a lot that comes out of the story alone. And that's why I'm saying, we are in an hour now where the Father is wanting us to be able to check our hearts, and we need to fear Him. And my goodness, this has been a week of such great testing, of great introspection, and I know that we all fall short in this area. But praise the Father, because I want to close off with this scripture from Leviticus 15. Sorry, Leviticus 14. May this be what the Father wants to do with us. Because remember, when the priests went into that time of them being equipped, when they went and they were being set apart by Moshe, Moshe took them apart and he first went and sprinkled with them the blood. They had to have the blood on the right ear, the blood on their right thumb, and the blood on the right toe. Then they were anointed with oil on the right ear, on the right thumb, and on the right toe. Now look and see. When they would come before him and they were now cleansed of the leprosy in Leviticus chapter 14, when it says in, from let's just read from verse 12, and the priest shall take one male lamb and bring it as a guilt offering and a log of oil and wave them as a wave offering before Yahuwah. And he shall slay the lamb in the place where he slays the sin offering and the ascending offering in a set apart place. For the guilt offering, like the sin offering, belongs to the priest. It is set apart. It is most set apart. And the priest shall take some of the blood of the guilt offering. So who became our lamb that took our guilt offering, that took our sin offering? And the priest shall take some of the blood of the guilt offering of, and the priest shall put it on the tip of the right ear. So may the Father in this day come and take the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach that was shed at Calvary at the stake, and may He come and anoint our right ear, so that we will not lend our ears to the devil and the enemy and the things that the enemy wants to speak in our ear, that's going to contaminate our mind, that's going to bring the undefiled thoughts in our mind, so that they can be cleansed. So may Abba cleanse us today with the blood of Yeshua Mashiach, our right ear, so that we may be able to come and be able to not listen to the voices of the enemy, and make a decision today that even if they want to speak things in your ear that is not what you should be hearing, silence them. Shall put it on the tip of the right ear of who is to be cleansed, and on the thumb of the right hand. So may the Father come and put the blood of Yeshua Mashiach on our right thumb to come and cleanse us from the works that we have done with our hands and the works that we have been about that has not been pleasing to Him. That because of what we thought, therefore we have allowed it to go into our hearts, Therefore we have spoken and therefore we have walked in it. So may the Father today come and cleanse us from the things that we have done that has been an abomination to Him because of the works that we have done that has been a defilement to Him. And may He come with His blood and bring the toe of the right foot. And may He come and cleanse our right toe so that our walk, our halakha, will be able to line up with everything that is in His Word. And that He will cleanse us from a walk that is impure before Him. That He will help us to walk righteous before Him. That we will keep His commands. That we will meditate on His commands in our mind. So that they may be that which will be spoken out of our mouths. So that they may be that which we will put into practice with our hands. So that they may be that which we will walk in the days of our lives. And the priest shall take some of the log of oil. So let us take the anointing oil. That when Yeshua died at the cross, He gave us the Ruach of Yahuwah to be able to come. The power of the Ruach. The anointing oil. The oil that He had to pay in the Garden of Gethsemane for His mind, His will and His emotions. Because that's where He had to die. A death. First to His mind, His will and His emotions. Before He died the physical death at Calvary. At the stake. So that we could receive that anointing oil. And may He bring that anointing oil today and pour it into His palm. And may He come, the palm of His left hand, and then with His right hand He takes it and He puts, the priest shall dip his right finger in the oil in his left hand and shall sprinkle some of the oil with his finger 7 times. Before Yahuwah, may that oil sprinkle 7 times over our lives to be able to cleanse us and to anoint us, that we will have an ear that hears the voice of the Father, that we will have a mind that will meditate on His ways and on His will and on His commands and on His word, and that we may be able to have a heart that is filled with Him, and that we may have a hand that will be anointed with the works that He has for us to do in these last days, and that we will be able to walk His purposes and His plans for our lives fully. For what we need to do in this time. Because for such a time as this, we have been created. So may He come with His blood to cleanse. And may He come with His oil to anoint. And to set forth. And to set apart. So that we may be able to go forth. That we will no longer be like Yahushua the high priest. With a dirty turban and dirty garments. Where we stand before the Father. Being accused by Hasatan. Because of our shortfallings. So I thank You, Abba Yahuwah, for this word that You have given us in this day. And I thank You, Abba Father, that You will do a great work in us in these remaining days. We truly want to be those, Father. We want to be a harvest that may be reaped at Shavuot. A wheat harvest for You, Father. So that You may be able to use this wheat harvest that You want to harvest in this time to go forth and become those that are going to be able to make a difference in this time. In the world as it gets darker and darker. Abba, I come before You and I repent. I repent on my behalf, Father, and I repent on behalf of Your people, Father. For what is going on in the body of Messiah. With a barricade of words that goes backwards and forwards and how we destroy one another with our tongues, Abba, my Father. The tongue is evil, Father. It's like a rudder that has no way of being able to be quieted. And it steers the whole ship. And our tongue will steer our whole body in the direction that we do not want to go. But I ask You, Father, that You would put a guard over our mouths. And now I've even seen this. I've even seen these masks being put over our mouths. Could it be that You wanted to mask us to be able to be silent now in this time? So that You may come and have Your will in us. So that when the masks are removed, we can speak Your oracles. We can speak Your words, Abba. I ask You, my King, That you alone will be able to come and take us out of the murray clay. Put our feet solid on the rock of Messiah Yeshua, who truly has paid the price for all. He came to heal the lepers, and what did he say? Go and show yourself to the priest. He didn't come to do away with Torah. He came to fulfill it. Even when he cleansed the leper, he said, go and reveal yourself to the high priest. Go reveal yourself to the priest. Abba, will you come and cleanse us, Father? Will you come and sprinkle your blood that you shed on the cross, the blood and the water that flowed on the earth, blood and water to come and cleanse us with the water and the blood? And then will you come and fill us with your anointing so that we may be those that may be able to go forth for you, Father? We do not want to be a vessel of destruction, Father. We want to be a vessel used for the glory and the honor of your name. Forgive us, Abba. Forgive me, Abba, my Father. May you truly come and have your way in us as we continue to count this Omer, to do the great work that you want to do at Shavuot, Father. I thank you, my King, that our minds will be filled with who you are and your presence and your word. And if we meditate more on you, we will not have time to be consumed with the things of this world. Let the things of this world become strangely dim, so that only that which is of you becomes more and more magnified. Thank you, Abba Yehua, for your grace, for your love, for your mercy. Thank you for paying the price. Thank you that in every area, when we more we look into this Torah, the more we see who you are and what you've done. Father, we do not want the leprosy in our lives, Father. But we want to be those that can be set free and instead become those vessels that may be able to speak the words that bring life. And wherever we are leprous in our lives, Father, I pray that you come and heal us. Whatever the diseases are that are dwelling within our hearts, that are still there, that is manifesting itself in our flesh, Father, reveal these things to us so that we may be set free and so that the enemy has nothing on us, Father. I praise and I thank you for this in Yahushua's name. Amen.